titled, I Am a Church Member. And we've been doing this because at the beginning of the year, we laid out some initiatives, three initiatives that we have as a church. And the first one that we talked about was recommitting to moving this church forward together. And as I said, throughout the year, we'll flesh out what that looks like. We'll talk more about what does it look like to move a church forward. But part of moving a church forward is really knowing what it means to be part of a church. What does it mean to be a church member? We don't always talk about church membership, and we certainly don't talk enough about responsibilities within church membership. So we've been doing this class and this study talking about what it is to be a church member and what are the responsibilities of a church member. So far, we've seen that for a church to move forward, we must all be functioning members. We all must find how we're supposed to function within the church and do that. Wanted to make sure my mic was on here. So it's important that we recognize that all of us have been gifted in different ways, and all of us are to use those gifts to build up and to serve the church. We also saw that for the church to move forward, we must be unifying members. We must be people that don't break people apart, but that want to bring people together, that want the church to come together, that we don't get involved in things like gossip and backbiting and things that become so easy for us sometimes, especially when we get frustrated with things, but that we become unifying members. And then last week we talked about for the church to move forward, we can't be focused on our own personal preferences and desires. We've got to recognize that God has called us here to serve, not to be served. Now the amazing thing that happens is that when we come to serve, when we pour ourselves out, our needs actually get met. But when we start focusing too much on our own personal needs and desires, then guess what? Not only do our needs not get met, but the other needs that other people have don't get met. So it's so vitally important. Well, this week we're talking about praying for and supporting our church leaders. You know, a lot of people today do a lot of things when they look for a church. And it's said that people determine the church, the statistics, I don't know if these are true or not, but the statistics say that people decide within the first 5 minutes if they're going to come back to a church. 5 minutes. Many times we haven't even gotten through the first song in 5 minutes. But a lot of times that's because of the ambiance or the experience. They've said that the number one reason why people decide whether they're going to come back to a church or not has to do with parking spaces. Okay? So there are a lot of different things that hinder people when it comes to church, but one of the things that comes up oftentimes is about the pastor. What is the pastor like? Is the pastor the perfect pastor that we're looking for? In fact, I saw a cartoon recently. Here it is. It actually is a pastoral search committee, and look at what it says. It says, basically, we're looking for an innovative pastor with a fresh vision that will inspire our church to remain exactly the same. And unfortunately, sometimes that's the kind of the mindset that people have with a pastor. We want somebody who can do all of these things. I've had many friends of mine who have looked for churches and have struggled to find it because they want a pastor with this incredible resume who will do all of these great things but also not change their church on how it is at all. And in reality, that person doesn't exist. The perfect pastor doesn't exist. And we have to understand that. We have to get our minds around that. Now, a lot of people have a different view of what pastoral ministry is. Some people think pastoral ministry is an easy job. I saw this cartoon that some of you will appreciate. It says, I want to be a pastor when I grow up. My pop says that it sure beats working. You know, there are a lot of people out there that have the mistaken notion that a pastor just works one day a week. Many people think that the pastor not only works one day a week, but then he works too long. Other people think that the pastor needs to look like this guy. And now when I dream about myself as a pastor, this is what I look like. But in reality, the pastor has so many things that they have to accomplish that oftentimes we don't look anything like this guy. Okay? And now many people would say, well, what does a pastor do? And in reality, the pastor's job description looks a lot like this. Okay? not just preacher and teacher, not just pastor, but you see project manager in there. There's a custodian in there, a co-custodian, life coach, mediator, and on and on and on we can go of things that people expect the pastor to do, and that can become downright overwhelming for a lot of people. In fact, just to talk a little bit about the state of pastoral ministry today, I'll share a little bit of statistics, but before I get into the statistics, let me share a personal story, because the personal story can kind of flesh out what a lot of people experience. When I was in seminary, I took a pastoral ministry class that was required for everybody that went through seminary to take this pastoral ministry class, and on the first day of class, the teacher got in front of a class of 32 students. And he said, I want to show you guys something that they're finding across all of the seminaries right now. He said, of the 32 students that are in this class, how many people here can envision themselves someday being the lead pastor of a church? Out of that class of 32 people, 10 of us raised our hands. Okay? So 22 people that were taking that class wanted to go into ministry, but not pastoral ministry as a lead pastor. And he said, now watch this. He said, how many of you that want to go into pastoral ministry, that want to be the lead pastor of a church, envision yourself being the pastor of an established church? Not planting your own church, but pastoring an established church that has been around for a long time. In that class of 32 people, two people raised their hand. And the teacher said, actually, statistically, this is more than what a lot of the classes will say. Many, many people today that are coming out of seminaries are not going in to be a pastor, and many more of those are not going to be the pastor of an established church. They're going to start their own church or work in a parachurch organization of some sort. Well, why is that? Well, the reality of it is because pastoral ministry, they're finding, has an excessively high burnout rate. In fact, here's some statistics of a survey that was done recently by Lifeway Ministries. Over 70% of the pastors are so stressed out and burned out that they regularly consider leaving ministry if they felt like they could. And a 57% of those said that they would leave if they had a better place to go, if they could see another place that they could go with their education. 70% of pastors fight depression on a yearly basis. Nearly 40% of pastors actually leave ministry within the first 5 years of ministry. Anywhere from 60 to 80% of pastors will not stay in the ministry past 10 years. Almost all pastors, and in fact, this particular survey that I read said 100% of pastors that they surveyed know a pastor who has left the ministry either because of burnout, because the church forced them out, or because of a moral failure. And the reality is I know that to be true. I know one pastor in particular who just left ministry a year ago, and another one that I think might leave ministry very soon because of some struggles that he's facing in his church. 77% say they don't feel like they have a good marriage and that the church is involved in that in some way. 75% said that they feel unqualified and poorly trained for the rigors of ministry today as it is. Whereas, and here's some really alarming, scary statistics, 30% of pastors admitted to having an affair. 35% of pastors admitted to struggling with some sort of a sexual sin of some sort, and in fact, I did a study on that when I was in school, and the statistics are a lot higher because there's 35% who will admit it, but there's a lot who won't admit it. So it's scary to think. Only 26% said that they have a regular personal devotion time and felt spiritually fit. Only 23% said they feel happy and content with who they are in Christ, in their church, and in their home. And only 25% said that a majority of their congregation attends Bible study at least twice a month. So pastoral ministry is incredibly stressful, and many people see that today and say, I don't want to have anything to do with it. Now, many people look at statistics like this, and they blame the people that are going into ministry. They say, well, it's the problem with the people. I don't like the cut of their jib in Exodus. They're just not prepared for it. Some people blame the seminaries. Others blame churches. Well, it's church people's fault. But I think that all of those miss the point. All of those really miss the greater point. It's not really about who's to blame. We can sit around and cast blame all we want, and even if we discover exactly who's to blame, what's that going to change? Probably pretty much nothing. What pastors and churches have to understand is that between pastors and churches, there's what we call a symbiotic relationship. A relationship where both depend on one another. It's the pastor's job to feed and care for the church, but the church also must care and support their pastor. Without both of these happening, these statistics will continue to get worse. So this morning we're going to do something just a little bit different than we've been doing in this study. We're going to take some time and we're going to look at, first of all, what God expects from church leaders. It's very important to understand what God expects from church leaders. And we're going to look at 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, because it's one of a couple of very clearly outlined ideas of what God expects from his church leaders. But as we look at that, some of us might look at it and say, well, that's great. This is a sermon for you, Pastor Ben. And in essence, part of it is. But as we hear this, I want us to understand, here's what God expects from the pastor, and continually ask ourselves the question, what does this mean for me? Not everybody here is called to pastoral ministry. In fact, most are not called to pastoral ministry here. But we all have a role and a responsibility in this, whether we're called to pastoral ministry or not. The second part of this sermon, we're going to talk about what church leaders need from their church. So we'll talk about both of those things, so hang in there, and we're going to move relatively quickly. So let's look at 1 Timothy chapter 3. Paul writes to Timothy, who was a young man in the Lord, who Paul had ministered to, who he had poured out into, who he'd raised up and discipled and mentored, and now he had sent Timothy to Ephesus. And Timothy's job in Ephesus was to help the church in Ephesus to grow and develop. He really called him there to be a pastor, to be a leader, to be an overseer, probably over a number of churches that were in Ephesus. In the olden days, which really wasn't that far back, we used to have people called directors of mission. And the directors of mission were guys who pastored a bunch of different pastors. So they didn't pastor all of the churches, but they were kind of like a pastor to a bunch of different pastors that were pastoring churches. I envision that that's kind of what Timothy did in Ephesus. And so Paul sends this letter to Timothy to encourage him. Paul writes this letter, one of his last three letters that he writes, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and Titus are very likely Paul's last writings, that he writes to Timothy to encourage him in his ministry and kind of give some last words to Timothy before Paul is executed. And so he says these words as he talks about the church and what the leadership of the church should look like. He says, "The saying is trustworthy. If anyone aspires to the office of overseer, he desires a noble task." Paul already once in chapter 1, verse 15, talks about a saying being trustworthy. Okay, why does he use this idea of trustworthy? Well, what Paul is trying to do is he's trying to say that I want you to pay particular attention to what I'm about to say, because this is something that if you apply it, it's going to help you out in the work that you're doing. It's trustworthy. You can trust what I'm saying here, that this is something that maybe other people have been talking about it, but it's something that we need to pay particularly attention, or that they want Timothy to pay particular attention to there in Ephesus. Now, in Ephesus, there was a major problem going on at this time, and it was the problem of false teachers. False teachers were raising up, some of them even raising up within the church. And they were taking over leadership positions, and they were teaching things that were wrong. And so one of the things that Paul does in 1 and 2 Timothy is he corrects the false teaching. He wants them to understand this is what true teaching is and this is what false teaching is. And it's very likely that the position of overseer or leader had become in disrepute at this time. That people kind of looked at it like, oh yeah, those guys are shady. We can't trust them. And so he says, this is trustworthy. Well, what's trustworthy? He says, if anyone aspires to the office of overseer. Now, we don't call our pastor overseer. Okay? Nobody's ever called me and said, overseer Trigstead? That would just seem kind of weird. But this particular word, overseer, it's translated different ways. In the older translations, it's translated as bishop. In newer translations, it's either overseer or elder. But the words overseer, elder, and pastor are all used interchangeably in Paul's writings. The role of an overseer or an elder or a pastor was one who looked over and guarded the flock, took care and ministered to the people. And so as we talk about overseer over here, we can see it very direct correlation between an overseer and a pastor. And so what he's talking about here is important for pastors. He says, if anyone aspires to the office of overseer, he desires a noble task. Instead of the disrepute that many people saw when it came to ministry, Paul says, no, it's a noble task. It's important because today many people, when they think about pastoral ministry, think of two things, either pastors or workaholics, which is true in many cases, or pastors are a place for lazy people, which unfortunately can be very true also. I've seen both. And many people, when they think about pastors, they think about pastors are only interested in getting people's money. Talking too long and getting people's money. That's what pastors do, right? Many people have that viewpoint, and what Paul is saying is, no, it is wrong. When he talks about a noble task, he's saying, this is something that's worthwhile. It's a worthwhile calling. It's interesting, though, and what Paul is going to say after this, is he doesn't say anything about the duties of a pastor. He doesn't say, here's what a pastor does. Here's the tasks that a pastor performs. All that he's going to say is about a pastor's character. Why does Paul do that? Well, because if the character is flawed, if the character of the pastor is flawed, then nothing else is going to come together. With a pastor, it always starts with character. And that's one of the challenging parts, but the important parts of a pastor's job. Many people can have jobs where their character can be a little bit questionable. But if they do the job, people don't worry about their character. It doesn't work that way with a pastor. If a pastor has a shady character, he can only hide that for so long. Pretty soon people are going to find that out, and they're going to run him out of town. Understandably so. Why? Because Paul makes it very clear here that a pastor's character counts. Pastor's character matters. Now, of course, there are other places in Scripture that we find about the vital duties of a pastor. Preaching and teaching, prayer, and caring for the flock. All of these are vitally important duties that a pastor has, but Paul wants to focus our attention instead on the character. And so what does he say? Look at verse 2. It says, therefore an overseer must be above reproach, the husband of one wife, sober-minded, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not a drunkard, not violent, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. Paul gives a long list here. And we're going to go through these relatively quickly, except for one or two of them, which we need to look at a little bit closer. But he starts off with above reproach. Now, when we see this idea of above reproach, we can mistakenly think that what Paul is saying is a pastor has to be perfect. Pastor can't have any sin in their life because they have to be above reproach. Now, here's the problem. If a pastor had to be perfect, how many people could be pastors? Nobody. Okay, just Jesus, right? Okay? That's not what Paul is saying here. What Paul is saying when he says above reproach is he means that they're not to be a flagrant sinner. They're not supposed to be somebody who pastors the church on Sunday but is off living a worldly, ungodly life the rest of the time. It's not a flagrant sinner. And in fact, everything else that Paul says in this section has to do with how somebody can be above reproach. So if we want to say, what does he mean by above reproach? Look at the rest of the things he says. The first thing he says there is the husband of one wife. The husband of one wife. Literally, the translation there is a one-woman man. Now, I'll talk a little bit more about this because this becomes an issue for people because they don't know exactly what he means by the husband of one wife. Some people will say, well, it's because of polygamy. The pastor can't be a polygamist. Other people say, no, it means that the pastor can't be remarried. If his wife died, he can't remarry anybody else. Some people say, no, what this means is that the pastor can't have been divorced. That if they were ever divorced, they can't be a pastor again. Others will say, no, all it means is that they need to be a one-woman man, that they can't be unfaithful to their wife, they can't be out philandering. Which was very common in the Greco-Roman world of the time, where people would be out kind of living this life, especially even people who were priests of various different ilks, that they would have their wife, but then they would go out and philander, and really there wasn't a lot that the wife could do about it. Okay? It was a very patriarchal society where the men could kind of do whatever they wanted. And so the question comes up is, what is Paul talking about here? Well, it's most likely talking about here that to be faithful to one's marriage. However, when we talk about that, understand that the other ones come into play too. Okay? So I think it's one of those things that we can look at and say, well, he's specifically talking about being faithful to your wife, but all of the other things come into play. The reality is the polygamist is not being faithful to his one wife, right? Yeah. So that's right out of there. But in reality, polygamy was not as widespread in the Greco-Roman world as many people think it was. Okay, it was in some of the various different cults and groups that were in the outlying areas, in areas like Africa and other parts of Asia, it was very widely practiced. But in the Greco-Roman world, it wasn't practiced as widely as other people think. Okay, those who are remarried do need to be examined very closely, not just given a free pass. We live in a society today that kind of approaches divorce as an on-demand sort of thing. Okay? And I don't think that automatically is going to disqualify people because of what is said here, but I do think we need to examine it very, very closely. What are the reasons behind there? What's the story behind it? And find out as much as we can. I go into that particular topic saying, you know what, let's be very careful about this. Okay? Why? Because God takes a very serious approach to marriage, doesn't he? Okay? And as a pastor, we have to understand that we are held to a high expectation. In fact, the real issue here, the real issue that Paul is getting at, is how one conducts themselves in marriage. If someone is unfaithful in their marriage, the most intimate, personal relationship that's possible between two people, if they're unfaithful in that, do you think that they're really going to be faithful with God's people? No. So we have to be very wise when it comes to what is this person's relationship like with women. Very, very important. And I think that's why Paul starts off with it. When I first got into ministry, my mentor, Omar Irby, he said that the three areas that get pastors quicker than anything else, money, women, and power. And he said, you need to set up hedges for yourself with all three. And I believe that's why he starts off with the issue of women, okay? Because it's important that pastors have that in check. The next thing he says is sober-minded. Now, this doesn't mean that they don't drink, okay? What it means is that they're clear-headed. Somebody who's not sober, who's inebriated, are they clear-headed? They might be empty-headed, but they're not clear-headed, okay? What he's saying is they need to be clear-headed, okay? You need to be somebody who's clear-headed. He says self-controlled. A self-controlled person is somebody who controls their impulses. We all have impulses, right? Sometimes we give in to those impulses. A person who's called to ministry ought to be somebody who can control the impulses, okay? He also says respectable. That means that they behave in a respectable manner, a way that is to be respected by other people. That their behavior is something that doesn't bring disrepute on the gospel or on Christ, but that they behave in a way that honors the calling. He says hospitable. This means welcoming to others. Okay? Somebody who is welcoming to people. This doesn't mean that the pastor is always going to be the friendliest guy in the room, but somebody who's welcoming to others, who greets others, whose home is opened up to others. He mentions able to teach. This is actually the one of all of these things, many of these things we can look at and say, you know what? That needs to be true of all of us. All of us need to be hospitable. All of us need to behave in a way that should be respected by others. But this is the one that's different for pastors and church leaders than others. Able to teach. Able to teach. This is a vitally important one. In fact, I believe, and this is my thoughts here, okay, so take it as that, but I believe that anybody who calls themselves pastor, ought to be able to preach and teach. Now that doesn't mean that they have to be able to preach and teach each and every day. Today we live in a time where there's lots of different pastor positions. There's executive pastors, there's worship pastors, there's youth pastors. I heard one church that has a pastor of creative arts. They don't know exactly what that is, okay? But there's lots of different people who are pastors. And that's all well and good, but I believe firmly that if somebody's going to call themselves a pastor, they ought to be able to correctly handle God's word when called upon. It's important. False teaching was a major concern in Ephesus. So this is particularly important and could have been the reason for Paul mentioning the qualifications of elders or pastors and deacons in this section. The false teachers were likely given positions of authority, and many people thought, well, we can't trust anybody who's in those positions. And Paul says, no. We need to set up guidelines for people in those positions. Next thing that Paul says is he goes over some knots. First thing he says is not a drunkard. Okay? Now this doesn't say that a pastor can never drink alcohol. What this means is that the pastor can't be a slave to intoxicating substances. Now again, I'll share my personal bias in there. I have no use for alcohol or any of the other intoxicating substances. I don't see any use to it. I don't like them. I've tried them when I was young, didn't like them. Okay? So I don't see any use. If a young pastor came up and said, hey, is it okay for me to drink? I would say, well, are you talking about what's okay or what's beneficial for you? Okay? Because if you want to say, is this biblically okay? Yeah, you could say that, but is it beneficial to you? I would say no. Okay? Because not only is it not going to add anything to you, but it's also going to be a stumbling block for people. Okay? If I drink alcohol, then other people are going to look at me and go, oh, it must be okay to drink alcohol. Now, I may be able to control my alcohol. That doesn't mean that other people are going to. So I found that it's better for me to just say, you know what? I'm not interested in it. Why? Because I don't want to be a stumbling block to anybody else. So Paul says not a drunkard. He also says not violent, but gentle. The church can't be led by a man who is prone to violence. Violence in words and violence in actions. A pastor who wants to run around and punch people in the mouth has no place being in the pastoral ministry. It says to be gentle. A gentle man is a patient man. Even with those that others might want to get violent with. But as I said, it's not just violence with physical violence. The reality is that most of us who are at least somewhat educated or somewhat mature know that it's not okay to go around and punch people in the face, right? We may have had people that we've wanted to do that before in our lives, but we know that it's not okay. But you know, we can also be very violent with our words. With the things that we say to other people. Both of those are important things. He says, not quarrelsome. Pastor shouldn't be a person who's always looking to get in verbal fights and arguments with people. Pastor instead is a peacemaker. This doesn't mean that we should be people pleasers. Doesn't mean that we need to be pushovers. Some people think that the pastor needs to be a pushover all the time. That's not what this is saying at all. What this means is that we not only must stand for what's right, but we also need to not be a person who enjoys getting into arguments and verbal sparring with people. That's not a place for pastors who like to kind of poke people and see if they can get them upset. Anybody have siblings that you like to do that to growing up? Okay. Thank you for raising your hand, Lydia. I know the truth there. Most of us like to do that when we were young to try to get people into arguments. Or when we got a little educated. Some of us got a little educated and we wanted to go show people how smart we were, so we'd try to get people into these arguments back and forth. Not a place for a pastor. Not something that a pastor is supposed to be doing, trying to argue with everybody all the time about everything. He also says not a lover of money. Some folks in the church say, yeah, we'll help you with that, pastor. You know, money should never be the goal of a pastor's life. We have to be wise with our money, and there's nothing sinful about a pastor getting paid for doing the job that he's called to do, but a pastor should never be driven by money. We should never think about money too much, where that's the biggest focus of our life. We ought to be people who give generously, who live simply, who aren't living a life of extravagance. See too many pastors today that are living these lives of incredible extravagance. I heard about one pastor. I actually had a call. A friend of mine called me up, and he had gotten called by Nashville, and they were doing a study because they were trying to find out how many pastors own two houses. Because I guess they had a problem in some places where pastors were owning two houses and taking the tax break that we get on our house on two houses. And so they were about to pass a bill in the Congress that you couldn't do that. And I laughed about it. I go, all the pastors I know can barely afford the house that we live in, much less have another one. But you know, unfortunately, some are paid so much and get so much that they're able to do that because money becomes such a focus of their ministry. Paul then gives three tests. Let's look at those very quickly. He says he must manage his own household well, with all dignity, keeping his children submissive. For if someone does not know how to manage his own household, how will he care for God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become puffed up with conceit and fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must be well thought of by outsiders so that he may not fall into disgrace, into the snare of the devil. Now, there are three sermons here in and of themselves, so I'm not going to do all of the exegetical work on all of what's said here, but let me just mention that all three of these are tests. Does the pastor manage his own household? How can he possibly manage the church if he can't manage his own household? Now, does this mean he's not going to have problems in his house? No, he's going to have problems with his house. But a key thing to watch is, how does the pastor deal with the problems in their house? How do they work through those problems? Because that'll tell you a lot about how they're going to work through problems at the church. Paul says, watch, how do they manage their household? If they can't manage their household, how in the world can they manage the church? He says, not a recent convert. Not a recent convert, not somebody who just came to faith. You know, one of the popular things a number of years ago was to get youth pastors in who were really young, hip, exciting guys who could draw lots of people in. And it worked to draw lots of people in, but you know what was happening a lot of times? A lot of those young guys were falling into various different sins. Unfortunately, sometimes even with the children that they were ministering to. Why? Because they were a recent convert. They weren't mature enough yet. Yes, they were cool, they were hip, they drew lots of people in. If they were really cool, they could play guitar. But they weren't mature enough for the rigors of ministry. They weren't mature enough to deal with the temptation. Paul says that the concern there is that they may become puffed up with conceit. Pastoral ministry is an area where people can fall to pride. And he mentions the devil here. That was the devil's fall also, right? Pride. It's very easy for pastors to, because we stand up in front of people and talk. Because people will sit for 30 to 40 minutes to listen to us talk. It's very easy for a pastor to kind of think, hey, you know what? I got it going on. That's why you need to be in ministry a little bit longer to realize that, you know what? I don't got it going on. And once I think I got it going on, I'm going to trip and fall on my face. Sometimes very literally. not a recent convert. And he also says, well thought of by outsiders. Now we may look at that and say, why is that? Many people outside the church think pastors are a bunch of scoundrels. Why would they need to be well thought of? Well, there's two reasons for that. One is to be an example. To be an example to other people. Yes, there are going to be some people outside the church who start off with a negative view about pastors for a multitude of reasons. We can turn that around. We can change people's view by the way that we behave, the way that we act. I remember a class that I took when I was working on my bachelor's degree. I took a human services, that was my degree, my undergraduate degree is social work. And I was one of only two conservative males in the entire program, which was one of the only, or was the only two conservatives in the entire program. And so oftentimes, we were in classes with just him and I and a bunch of women who were extremely on the other side of the political spectrum and everything else on every situation. So you can guess who a lot of their venom came towards. We got a lot of it. But I got a chance because I was in that program for 2 years until I graduated. And I got a chance to be able to minister to a lot of their families. I did weddings for some of the people. I did some counseling with some of them. I walked with some of them through some of the storms of life. April became friends with some of them, even led one of them to Christ. One day there was this lady who just had a chip on her shoulder. And she just came in angry all the time about everything. And she tore into me and tore into pastors. And I just sat there and took it. And an amazing thing happened. All of these people who usually disagreed with me about everything turned on her. And basically said, you may think that about other pastors, but we've been around Ben long enough to know that he's not like that. I didn't have to say one word. I didn't say anything. I know that's shocking, isn't it? I didn't say anything. Why? Because other people did it. I was able to give a good example of what a pastor's supposed to be just by the behavior. The other part of it is to not bring disrepute on the church or on Christ. It's very important. Many people see the guys on TV and they think the pastors are all out there with their shenanigans and whatnot, looking to get people's money. They can cry on command. And all of these other things. It brings disrepute on the church and unfortunately on Christ. So it's very important that we're respected by outsiders. That's a lot of stuff, isn't it? It's a lot of things. It's a really, if we're going to summarize this to a very simple statement, it would be that there must be clear evidence in a pastor's life of the work of the Holy Spirit. Not perfect, or no one could be that, but do we see clear evidence of the Holy Spirit working in this man's life? Pastor is held accountable. Held accountable to the church, but more importantly, held accountable to Christ. Because Christ is the true authority of the church, not the pastor. Okay, so we talked a lot about what the expectations are of pastors. Hearing all of those things, the question is, what do church leaders need from the church? What do pastors and other church leaders need from the church? And really, there's four things that I believe that pastors and church leaders need from the church more than anything else. And if you miss everything else, please catch these things. Yeah. The first one is this, prayer. This is the most important. And in fact, in the book this week, as you read through the I Am a Church Member book, you're going to see the great calling of praying for your pastor daily. Your pastor needs it. As Thom Rainer will say in this chapter of the book that we're going to read this week, that the devil is working overtime against church leaders. It's what he does. We need your prayer. We need you to continually pray for your pastor. We look at these things and these responsibilities and expectations when it comes to a pastor's character, and it's challenging. We don't have a church continually praying for us. We're in trouble. Next, involvement. One of the greatest things that we can ask for of a church is that people would be involved. You know, one of the things that does my heart well is when I see people in our church doing things, doing ministry, whether it's within the church or outside the church. I got a great opportunity a couple weeks ago to go to the veterans meeting what an incredible experience that was to watch as various different veterans from our church are part of this American Legion group that have an opportunity to not only minister and care for vets, but also get in these men's life. Some of these men, if they hear that I'm a pastor, they're going to keep me at arm's length. But you know, when a veteran comes up and talks to them, they'll listen to them. Why? Because they experience some of the same things. And then all of a sudden they see that, you know what? Christians aren't all a bunch of weirdos. Just some of us are. I walked away from that meeting feeling as about encouraged as I have in a long time. Why? Because I can see that people are putting what we've been talking about into practice. Pastors love to see involvement. People involved in the church. People doing things. People getting involved in ministry. Next, encouragement. Encouragement is such a big deal. Pastors, as I shared with those statistics, deal with a lot of struggles. You know that pastors, almost all pastors that I've met, at some point write a resignation letter on Monday. It's true. Many pastors write resignation letters on Monday. Why? Because Sunday can be very overwhelming, very difficult, very challenging. We need to be encouraged. You know, the best way that you can learn how to encourage, not just your pastor, but anybody. Find it in Gary Smalley's book, The Five Love Languages. I would really highly recommend that you read that book. It helped me so much. When I was young in my relationship with April, my love languages are gifts and words of praise. And that's what I always tried to do with April, is to do give her gifts and give her words of praise. And I never could understand why she didn't feel loved. And then we went through that together, and I learned that her love languages are quality time and acts of service. And so I was trying to love her in a way that she didn't speak that language. So you know what I found out? Instead of bringing her home flowers, I could do the dishes, and she felt more loved by that than by the flowers. Hey, that worked out well for me because it saved me money, right?
Yeah.
I could show her my love for her a lot better by spending time with her, carving time out of my schedule, and say, this is time just for April. It is so vital that we learn what the love languages are and try to figure out what people's love languages are. It's the great way to encourage us. Usually we try to encourage people according to our own love language, but when we learn their love language, it's a lot easier for us to tell them that they're loved by us. And the final thing is support. Support. Support is family. What's going on in your pastor and your church staff's family? You know, our family becomes a vitally important thing. I spend a good portion of my time of my life trying to do things with my family. Support the family. What's going on in the family? What are they dealing with? Support also his personal strengths. One of the challenges that comes for many pastors today is a lot of people expect the pastor to be like the pastor that they liked before. Oh, Pastor so-and-so, he used to do all of these great things. He used to just be like this, and why can't you be more like Pastor so-and-so? And that's not fair. Each of us are designed in different ways, and if we believe that God has put the pastor where he's put them, then what we're saying is that God wants that person with his gifts to bring his gifts out, and that's okay. If that pastor tries to be all of these other things, he'll never succeed. What is my pastor's gifts? What does he do? What does he bring? Yeah, he might not bring this or that. A wise pastor will try to get people around them that will be able to do those things that he doesn't do so well. But what does our pastor do really well? Support him in those things. Because he's probably designed that way. Maybe in the future somebody else will come that has some other gifts. Ones that you might like more. Or that might be the guy that you look back and say, you know, pastor that came before you, he did all these great things. So support your pastor. Prayer, involvement, encouragement, and support. That's what your pastor needs from his church. Let us pray.